Right. Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining us for Quantum today. I'm John Donahue, the Scientific Outreach Manager at the Institute for Quantum Computing. The IQC is a multidisciplinary research institute at the University of Waterloo studying the potential and development of quantum information science. We have researchers working on the cutting edge of physics, chemistry, mathematics, computer science, and engineering. And during Quantum today, we'll be looking closer at the research happening at the quantum level. Please feel free to ask any questions you have in the chat box throughout the event, and we'll get to as many as possible before wrapping up. Before we get started, we do have one quick announcement. There is just over 1 month left to apply for the 2024 Undergraduate School on Experimental Quantum Information Processing, or USQIP. USQIP is a two-week summer school that will be held next June, bringing 30 undergraduates from around the world to the University of Waterloo campus for a hands-on deep dive into quantum technologies. Whether you're interested in physics, engineering, chemistry, mathematics, or computer science, it's a great way to learn about what makes quantum technology work. You can also apply for a paid summer research term with IQC professors at the same time as your USQIP application. Applications are due January 2nd. You can check out the website for more details. Today, though, we'll be discussing quantum ethics. So quantum technologies are a rapidly developing area. In particular, quantum computing has gone from a niche subfield to a blossoming industry in only a couple decades. With any rapid advancement in technological ability, it's also important to ask questions about who these developments benefit and how to develop these ideas in a thoughtful, inclusive manner. In this vein, there have been calls for a deeper look at quantum ethics. Here to discuss this field with us today are two members of the Quantum Ethics Project, an international collaborative effort to bring these issues to the forefront of the discussion. Joan Arrow is the founder of the Quantum Ethics Project and has recently started a new role as the Deputy Director of Education and Workforce Development for the QSense Quantum Leap Challenge Institute. Özge Gülsayin is the Waterloo Chapter Lead of the Quantum Ethics Project and a Bachelor's of Science student in the Department of Physics and Astronomy at the University of Waterloo. Joan and Oz, thank you so much for joining us today.
Hello.
Thank you so much, John. It's great to be here.
I'm so glad to hear. So I want to get started with the big picture. So we talk about quantum ethics. What does that mean to you? And maybe I'll start with Oz on this one.
Yes. For me, I think it's all about responsible research and innovation. Like, I think having a moral like framework in which we do research and not have it be an afterthought. So have that like ethical framework embedded in our research is what quantum ethics, like all the discussions that we had, is about.
Absolutely. And just to build off of that point that Oz made around responsible innovation, and I want to motivate a little bit the importance of an ethical framework. In quantum computing specifically, which was my field when I was studying at the University of Waterloo, I worked on quantum algorithms. And in quantum algorithms, our holy grail is achieving quantum advantage, ideally through some sort of exponential speed up on a computational task. And, you know, there's no shortage of evangelists who are selling how transformative exponential speed up would be for our society. And if you're telling me that you're trying to exponentially impact society, then in my view, that conversation has to include a discussion about how do we ensure that that transformation is positive? Because technology can swing both ways. Technology can transform society for the better, and it also can transform society for the worse. And it often does both at the same time. And so engaging in these discussions around ethics, for me, is a way that we can try to push the probability of the qubit a little bit towards positive, so that we get more likelihood for positive outcomes and we restrict the likelihood for negative outcomes. If we can foresee a bad use case, we should talk about it and we should find ways to do better.
Mm-hmm. So both of you are working in kind of quantum ethics now. Joan, I'd like to ask you, what got you interested in the quantum algorithms research originally? Kind of looking to eventually ask how that changed from that to focusing more on the ethics side.
Yeah, that's I appreciate the question. I mean, you were talking just now about this USQIP program. And for me, it was a similar type of, I did a summer research experience for undergraduates REU program, which is a United States-based National Science Foundation-funded program where students can apply to work on a research project at many universities across the country. If they get in, they get their all expenses paid to fly to that university. They'll put you up in room and board, and you get to spend the whole summer working on math or physics or chemistry or something else. I got to work on quantum computing. And as an undergraduate, I had always been interested in quantum mechanics and loved getting into those discussions, you know, the philosophical discussions, you know, from Einstein or, you know, any of these founders of the field who were simultaneously creating a discipline and also baffled by it. And the idea that you could take that fantastical, true science fiction and turn it into a technology that could positively impact the world, that was tremendously exciting for me. So when I was fortunate enough to be admitted to the University of Waterloo's program, I explored a lot of different areas, but eventually settled on quantum algorithms. And specifically, I focused on a portion of quantum algorithms that integrates machine learning. And that's, I think, where some of the conversations around machine learning and artificial intelligence ethics, we talk about AI ethics, I think it's a pretty topical field now with the rise of ChatGPT and other things. And I think some of those ideas started to cross-pollinate when I was working on my master's thesis. And when I finished my master's thesis, I was thinking, you know, hey, we're talking about, you know, making this godlike technology. Why aren't we talking about ethics the way the AI folks are?
Mm-hmm. No, absolutely. And I think the way that you describe how you got into this, the specifics vary a lot from person to person, but I think that's a relatively common story in the broad strokes where it's like, hey, we learn about all this cool stuff and then someone gives you the information that, oh, and it's actually potentially useful for something cool. Mm-hmm. And it's like, okay, let's go work on it. And then by the time we get to something like now, it's just like, oh, it actually might be useful soon-ish. How do we make sure that it's going to be used responsibly becomes a very important question. Mm-hmm. So Oz, as an undergraduate student, what sparked your interest in quantum ethics and quantum ethics?
I would say our university really primes you to love quantum, I would say, thanks to IQC being in our campus as well. I had so many great quantum courses. Actually, it's insane how much upper year quantum courses are available for the undergrads here, I would say. I was checking out other universities and there's way less. So
I had
about
two.
Yeah. So that blows my mind because I don't know, I had five at this point. And last fall, I was taking three courses on quantum. And it was I think that's when it clicked for me. There was this one specific course, Quantum Theory 2. And I was oh my God, it makes sense now. And I was able to see we were seeing the same material basically in different contexts. And I really loved it. And as for the ethics, I would say there is this club, FemPhys on campus. And in their room, so I got involved with FemPhys, and in the room, there's this bookshelf full of feminist philosophy of physics, history of physics, philosophy of history of physics and stuff like that. And I just randomly started reading those, and it kind of I was so fascinated by it because it was talking about things like, is science objective? How do we put our own morals into the knowledge that we produce? And I was like, this is so interesting, but I was also not fully understanding it. Anyways, I also took an environmental ethics course alongside with the quantum courses I was taking that term. And literally the term next, the winter term after that was Joan reached out to FemPhys and was like, I have this quantum ethics project and I definitely would want FemPhys to be involved. And at the time, Sarah was in correspondence with Joan, and she just asked, does anybody else want to come? And I was like, oh, quantum ethics, that sounds so interesting. And then I also was at the meeting. In fact, I was looking back and I was like, wait, I was almost not going to go to that meeting because I was like, I'm not feeling that well that day. But then I don't know. I remember being on the second floor of IQC, just sitting at a table at that kitchen. And then Joan was telling me these things that I was reading and like I have learned on like environmental ethics now being applied to like this quantum context. And I was like, oh my, I was like, I could not stand still. I really want to help. How can I get involved? So it's like, thank you, Joan, for reaching out to Memphis.
We're very lucky that you decided to come that day.
Yeah, right? Yeah.
That's right. Sometimes you just got to go to the meeting.
All right. Yeah, just show up.
You never know where it's going to take you. Joan, so along those lines, you launched the Quantum Ethics Project in 2021. What was the vision then, and how has it evolved since?
Yeah, so the original vision was heavily based on my experience as a graduate student at the IQC. There are the core quantum information processing courses that a master's student like myself would need to take. You've got your algorithms or your information processing course, QIC 710. You've got your experimental course, QIC 750, that talks about the devices. I struggled through that one. I'm not an experimentalist, but made my way through it. And I just had this feeling that, you know, the IQC is such a premier institute for the study of quantum information. Why isn't quantum ethics part of my curriculum? And why aren't there faculty around me doing research on this? Why don't I have the opportunity to see talks on this topic at the IQC? And it, to me, just seemed like, the topic was relatively new. Quantum is as old as I am. I date quantum by the date of Shor's algorithm being published, 1994, 1995. That's when I was born. But quantum ethics, maybe 5 years old, maybe six, very, very young. And in 2021, right, only 3 years since, you know, some of the early, larger conversations around this had started happening. I wouldn't say it's like an intentional blind spot of the IQC, but it's just like it was too new. So the original goal was I didn't know anything about the topic. And so I started reaching out. I actually was a member of FemFiz since I came to NAU, or excuse me, since I came to Waterloo, and reached out through my old networks in FemFiz because I knew of folks from cohorts that had graduated around the time that I arrived that had been talking about quantum ethics before I got to Waterloo. And so through a couple of initial introductions and first set of connections, I started just kind of branching out and talking to more and more people. And as of the start of this year, I had talked to, I think, 100 or more researchers across the globe who work on quantum and society, quantum and ethics, quantum governance, these various sorts of topics that tend to fall under the umbrella when we talk about quantum ethics. We're really talking about everything to do with the intersection of the technology and the people who are developing and then using it. So as of now, we're just about to come into 2024. The vision for the Quantum Ethics Project, the spirit of it, has remained very much the same. One of the core kind of pillars of our activity, and if you want to throw up the image that we shared of kind of the three pillars, one of our core pillars of activity is education. And these are the first kind of activities that we did earlier this year with the Perimeter Institute, which were, we came in and we did an hour lecture to their PSI master's students on what is quantum ethics, and trying to get this conversation about the societal use of quantum technologies put into programs like Perimeter's PSI, and ideally put into the IQC's programs as well, so that students can be introduced to these topics early and have the opportunity to see themselves as ethical actors. That's our kind of primary goal with all of our education. There's no right or wrong answers in a field that's really lives inside of the umbrella of philosophy. We're just trying to equip researchers, students, and anyone who is interested with the tools and critical frameworks necessary to come to your own conclusion of what ethics means to you, and then actualize that as a quantum member of the quantum community. These other two pillars, I think diversity and outreach is very much a sister pillar to education, where in my view, you know, this came from one of the very first conferences that I had the pleasure to attend to promote the Quantum Ethics Project. It was a conference on the governance of quantum technologies at Yale. It was jointly hosted by Yale, UCLA, and I can't remember. I think it was TUM, Technical University in Munich. It was the Yale Transatlantic Quantum Forum. And at this conference, we were discussing governance, one of these, you know, subtopics within quantum and society. And we're, you know, most of the conference was lawyers or policy experts who were trying to talk about, you know, if we had a working quantum computer, if we had a working quantum network, what are the regulatory and policy guardrails that are necessary, as we were discussing, to mitigate those negative impacts and promote the positive. There's a lot to be done in that field, because I think quantum ethics, part of the reason why it's taking a little bit of time to get off the ground is because it's so interdisciplinary, and because it crosses interdisciplinary boundaries that typically you don't see crossed. You know, in my department, we're in the combinatorics and optimization department. While I was at Waterloo, they considered themselves a pure math department, even though the optimization is core to how everything works. You know, we optimize productivity yield, we optimize agricultural yield, we optimize all of these things. And I believe that there are moral judgments that can be inputted into the types of cost functions that we optimize. That's a separate topic. But the point is, when we're talking about trying to regulate an emerging technology, I counted on one hand the number of people in that room who were from a marginalized background. People of color, less than 5. You know, I was the only trans person in the room, certainly. And so the idea that we can create solutions that protect marginalized communities, because these are the communities that we typically understand as being the ones that are going to see the worst of the negative impacts. We've seen this with AI. We've seen this with virtually the development of every new technology since the Industrial Revolution. So if we're going to try and develop solutions that are equitable, that protect marginalized communities, and we're trying to do that without including any marginalized voices in the room, without having a person, a policy expert who understands the implications of technology and the intersection with race, then we're missing the point right out of the gate. So education, diversity, and outreach together fold into, you know, my work in education and workforce development. When I think of developing a workforce for the quantum revolution, to me, that workforce, by definition, if it's going to be ethical, it has to be diverse and it has to be equitable. And then finally, the central pillar, which is, you know, core to what we do through our collaborations at the Center for Quantum Networks and other centers that we partner with, is that we come into these organizations that are doing quantum research, and we leverage our expertise to show them how can you make sure that you're doing impactful research that brings in these intersections, you know, bridges these gaps between these disciplines like mathematics or ethics, and really does that in an impactful way. It's not easy to do. And every, you know, there's lots of quantum organizations out there that care about responsible innovation, that care about ethics, but who nevertheless are running into one or another of the kind of pitfalls you find as you walk down this path towards ethics, towards responsible innovation. There's a lot to be done to make sure that these groups can talk to each other well, that they collaborate well. And so finding ways to do fundamental research in quantum ethics so that we can then come in as expert consultants to work with these organizations, that's kind of the emerging collaborative model going forward.
Amazing. So you mentioned that some of these sessions came up through workshops that were really sponsored by kind of an international cohort of research institutes. I was wondering, could you provide us a little bit of insight about the global conversation about quantum ethics is? We're oftentimes used to dealing with whatever's kind of in our local environment when we're in one of these quantum hubs. Is this something that is being embraced in certain regions of the world, or is it something that kind of everyone needs to be focused more on?
No, I mean, I would actually say that Canada and the United States, North America has fallen behind. So this is, you know, when I talked about the 100 or so researchers that I talked to over since, you know, fall 2021 to January 2022, what became clear to me, especially after that Yale conference, is that there are several well put together groups in Europe that are just plowing forward. Trying to think of some names that are coming to mind, but TU Delft is very involved. They have a Center for Quantum and Society, if memory is serving. There's a new research or a new quantum ethics organization that's been founded out of Geneva by Matthias Troyer and others. They specifically focus on aspects of this conversation that relate to international, like kind of geopolitical dynamics. They talk a lot about, you know, countries who are developing quantum versus countries who are having their access to quantum restricted. And you should, you know, you can see it if you look at IBM's, you know, opportunities for quantum research. They have a long list of countries who are banned, whose citizens are banned from participating. And there's, you know, it's not my particular area of expertise within the quantum ethics umbrella, but those are the types of issues that Matthias Troyer and those in the at the Geneva group are really prioritizing. The issue that they primarily are highlighting is who is being left behind in this quantum revolution in kind of international setting. Australia has a large group, actually somebody who's Dr. Shahini Ghosh, who just released a book. She's an incredible friend and a wonderful mentor, and has been very involved with the FemPhys community as well. She's an advisor on that project, or was when I was looking at it a few years ago. So Australia is working on this. Europe is working on this very heavily. Those are the main two kind of groups that I'm aware of. I think I could count maybe one organization that is maybe tangentially working on this in the United States. But when you look at North America, we're really lagging. And that's kind of been part of what sometimes makes me pull my hair out a little bit is when I get pushback from departments like combinatorics, and they say, well, you know, ethics really isn't part of what we do. I just point to all these other groups at all these other universities who are already doing this. And, you know, things like, you know, the University of Waterloo's president, Vivek Goel, I had the pleasure of being on a panel with him about a month ago before I left Canada. And, you know, he's got this interdisciplinary research initiative across campus where the university is trying and in many cases succeeding to really advocate for novel combinations of topics to give rise to novel research. And I think you do have some holdouts. You know, the pure math people maybe are unused to, you know, it's like water and oil. They're a little unused to pairing with folks from the social sciences. But as Oz was pointing out, if you pick up a book on, you know, the philosophy of science or the development of these fields, you right away, you run into all of these fascinating issues at the intersection of human endeavor, which is what math and physics are, and the social issues that humans have to deal with, that we talk, you know, that people study in the social sciences.
Yeah, and I would like add that interdisciplinary work is so important because we had this event like earlier this term where a philosophy professor here, Professor Dr. Doreen Fraser, she gave a talk on like moral responsibilities of scientists. And one thing that she said to me really stuck out because she was saying how sometimes like research ethics is being offloaded into these like ethical boards. So you approve a project before, and then once it's approved, like the scientists who are working on them don't need to think about the ethical implications. And what she was saying that, new moral issues come out as you do research. And so you have to think about it throughout, like from conception to the end. And that only the scientists are equipped with the knowledge to know what is the actual impact. Because like, sometimes we can underestimate, sometimes you can overestimate, right? And hello.
Oh, sorry, you cut out for a second there.
Yes. Okay.
Yeah, it was only for a minute, saying, though.
Okay, sorry. I was saying only the scientists are able to assess this risk, but we are not equipped with that like kind of thinking, I would say. So I think having that like education on thinking like an ethicist is so important, and the interdisciplinary work is so that you can go to another person who has experience on that and talk it through throughout your research. So yeah.
And just about just to add to that, I mean, that's that point that Oz made is so crucial. And you know, many times when I would have conversations with folks about this topic, they would say, okay, sure, maybe ethics is an interesting topic, but this is not the place to research it. You yeah. should go to the philosophy department. You should go to a humanities department. You should get out of the IQC or, you know, out of the quantum field, and you should work on it. And this is actually a point that ethicists writ large frustrates them. I was, you know, I follow this this tech ethicist on TikTok, and you know, maybe it's odd to reference somebody from TikTok, but she made the analogy of like a construction site. So construction sites have OSHA, which is the organization in charge of safety on the job site, and the analogy was. The average worker might say, well, if I find a rusty nail sticking out of the floor, that's really OSHA's job to deal with. But the counter argument is that when you're, you know, the single ethicist in the room cannot possibly have the level of proximity to and expertise in the topics that are being worked on by the researcher, or in this case, the construction worker on the job site is the one who found the rusty nail. They need to at least know how to handle that situation, how to bring the ethicist in, or how to deal with the situation themselves. And I think this is why so much of the work at the Quantum Ethics Project is about breaking down these barriers between tech and ethics, and trying to train technologists in ethical thinking, and also maybe give ethicists some exposure to the technology. But the basic idea is that if you are working on a novel piece of technology as a technologist, and you don't have a background in ethics, well, then you might end up being Robert Oppenheimer.
Fair. anyway,
kind yeah. of,
oh, sorry.
Oh, I was just going to add, it's so crazy how like you can say the exact same thing, but with diversity, when you change like ethicists into like more diverse scientists, because when we have a more like diverse like group of scientists, or just a diverse group, like this is like more philosophical, but like in like epistemology, like the knowledge that you produce is actually a higher quality, because like if you're like just like the ethicist is able to see some of the ethical like pitfalls, when you come from another like background, like personal identity background, you are able to see some of the things that the other people might not have seen. So we saw that a lot in AI and how it would like not see like dark skin, for example. Like that's such a big like blind like point that like sometimes you don't see it, and it's because you did not have the diverse group to work on it. So yeah, just like having interdisciplinary, like it's the same like idea. We produce better and like more quality knowledge and technologies.
And economists also agree with you, Oz. There's a great book, The Diversity Bonus by Scott Page. Where he basically tries to argue from the perspective of economics, like a pragmatic argument for diverse teams, and shows like, I'm not deeply familiar with his argument, but the idea, the takeaway is exactly what you've just said. Teams with diverse modes of thought, either from backgrounds related to diversity or from backgrounds from different disciplines, produce better results because they're thinking from these different directions.
I think there was one specific example you brought up in there that I think is fairly, might be a little illustrative to people who come into it from a research background. And that was the example of IBM restricting access to its open source tools. When I think about the kind of people who work on a lot of those tools, they probably come to it from a very scientific background. They're happy to be working on open source tools, really interested in the science, really interested in making sure it's open source. But you're working in a different power structure, all of a sudden those kind of decisions are going to be above your head. And that's something that, you know, when you're working in a university, yes, you have that to a lower extent. But when you start moving into companies, this becomes something you have to consider much more deeply. That's one thing that a lot of people don't think about so much is like, okay, it's not so much about what you're doing, but how could it be used later down the line? I do want to bring in a question that we had from the audience from Amy Gunther, speaking specifically about the kind of ethical problems that people working in quantum technology might need to think about. In particular, when we talk about quantum ethics, it can often sometimes seem to be synonymous with quantum computing ethics. Is there any other quantum technology application areas where we do need to consider these ethical implications as well?
1000%, Amy, and thank you so much for asking that question. I talk a lot about quantum computing because that is where my research background lies. But because of my new role working for QSense, which is a quantum sensing research institute in Colorado, and also working as a research fellow for the Center for Quantum Networks here in Arizona, I've had the pleasure to talk with researchers who work in quantum networks and quantum sensing, which I consider to be the other two pillars of quantum technology. Folks sometimes will separate quantum computing from quantum simulation, but the way I think about it, you've got computing, simulation, and networks. And we've touched very well on computing. So what are the issues that you might find from these two? And I'll just give two examples. At the Center for Quantum Networks, one of the flagship applications of quantum communication technologies is quantum key distribution. And, you know, I've had the pleasure to work with John on some of the high school lab days where we bring in high school students and we demonstrate quantum key distribution using a very cute, nice little photonics board. And the idea behind quantum key distribution is that they exploit the fragility of a quantum state to ensure that communication via those quantum states is perfectly secure, meaning that not to say that people can't eavesdrop on what you're saying, but if someone were eavesdropping, you would always know. You can instantly, oh, we're being listened to. You can cut the communication and have that secure communication. Who do you suppose, Amy, really wants that technology? Perfectly covert communications, it's not even kind of a riddle. The Center for Quantum Networks has multiple industry partners who are part of the military industrial complex. And the punchline is that, would your grandma need QKD? I don't think so. Would an average person need QKD? I personally think probably not. So QKD is an example of a technology where, in my experience, and again, this is not my area of expertise. Maybe someone from Quantum Networks can point out a more positive application that I haven't heard anyone point out through my conversations, but QKD is an example of what we call a dual use technology. And if you, John, if you throw up that three pillars diagram one more time, there was a bottom portion of that where we talk about some of the key issues within quantum ethics that we talk about, and dual use is right there front and center. So that's not to say that, because there aren't positive use cases even for the military. Like, I could make a positive ethical argument like this. Let's say my cousin is serving overseas and I equip them with their unit with QKD. So they can be certain that their communications related to their position or their movements are not being listened into. Maybe I make my cousin more likely to come home after deployment. So it's not to say that just because something could be used by the military, it is necessarily bad. I have personal feelings about my technology being used for war that I personally feel I do not want my brilliance, my time, my energy to go towards, wars that I might not believe should be fought in the first place. But the purpose of these discussions is just to highlight the issues. And I consider my job to be well done as an ethics educator if I leave my students with a sense of cognitive dissonance, where you can see conflicting good arguments for both cases, and it's up to you to decide what to do with that information. So that's an example from quantum networks. An example from quantum sensing, let's go over to sustainability in the environment, which was just to the right of the dual use icon from that figure. I personally feel that we need to be doing everything we can as researchers and as people to battle climate change. But one of the primary uses of a quantum sensor, they're essentially a very precise clock. And what this very precise clock can do is it can measure time so precisely that if for people who are familiar with general relativity, the people will know that if you put a clock deep in a gravitational field or higher up in a gravitational field, those clocks will tick at different rates. And for people who may not have heard of this, go talk to Einstein about it. He's the one that saddled us with this idea. But the basic idea is that if you build a clock that is precise enough, it can tell the difference between being on a table and an inch above that table. And we're building quantum clocks with that level of precision today. So think about what you've just built. You've built a machine that can very sensitively perceive the gravitational field. So here's a use case. Oil companies could use this to discover regions under the ground which are either more or less dense than your average rock and dirt. They could use this to discover natural gas reserves or oil reserves. So by building this quantum clock, we are giving oil companies the ability to continue to cause problems for the environment. Or the other side of that argument could be we're giving oil companies the ability to better support our civilization's need for consuming oil and gas, and maybe we get them to, you know, bring the gas prices down cheaper. I have trouble making a positive argument for this one, and this is just my own personal bias. I'm very sustainability and environmentally minded. But those are two examples of either networks or sensors which carry with them, you know, people. You know, you want to think about who is funding this research and who is really interested in the output or the eventual use of that research. You've got the oil industry for quantum sensing. And that's not to say all of quantum sensing is just for the oil industry or all of communication is just for the military. But those are two kind of examples of ethical dilemmas within those other parts of the field.
Awesome. Thank you for that. So I just want to play devil's advocate a little tiny bit. So quantum computing's had a lot of rapid growth recently. And despite some excess hype in the field right now, claims that it being commercially useful today are a bit academically dubious. Quantum sensing and other applications, yeah, you're right, we're developing these new kinds of gravity sensors that have more power than they might have had in the past, but things like MRIs and photon counters have been used in kind of the most ethically fraught fields we can possibly imagine, healthcare and the military. So why is today the time for quantum ethics and not either 10 years ago or 10 years from now?
Oz, do you want to take that one? Should I? Who's that? Who are you pointing that question at, John?
Open field.
I mean, I'll take a stab at it. I mean, this is a question that I get a lot, right? Like, and I actually appreciate the opportunity to answer it while being recorded, because now anytime someone asks me this question, I can just point them to your YouTube channel. And the argument I'll make is look at what AI did wrong. So AI was a technology, you know, started off in the 1950s. It went through a couple of research winters where the hardware really couldn't keep up with the promises that were being made by researchers, and investment pulled out and research slowed to a crawl. They had a bit of a renaissance, I think, in the 70s or the 80s. Don't quote me on that number. And then it wasn't until the birth of the internet and the kind of computing power that we see, you know, maybe in the early 2000s, that AI started to be... you know, more useful. Again, I'm playing fast and loose with these dates, so nobody come at me with this. But that's kind of the rough story of AI. And throughout the just development of AI, there were, you know, AI ethicists weren't really part of the discussion. The technology was far from being developed. People were waiting for it to see what the technology could do. And look at where we are today. We are in a position where the technology arrived and became useful so fast and is now so powerful that even when, you know, I think it was earlier this year or last year that a lot of these Silicon Valley, you know, talking heads like the CEO of Apple or, you know, these other people signed a petition saying we needed to have a stop on the development of things post ChatGPT 4. And, you know, literally my research advisor at the time just laughed at that concept. Right, there's this idea now that this new technology is here, it's powerful, it's useful, it's now triggered an arms race. And that arms race, similarly in the case of Oppenheimer and the nuclear bomb, basically erases any possibility of an ethical conversation to begin with. Because if somebody says, oh, let's stop and be ethical about this, the argument can just be, well, the other guy is going to do it first, and then we're going to lose. So, you know, AI ethicists are doing incredibly important work in showcasing the harms that AI can do. Oz earlier mentioned that AI facial or visual recognition systems are laughably bad when it comes to recognizing faces with dark skin. And as the gradient of the skin goes down, this is research that's been shown by black researchers in the field. You know, think about the implications that has for police departments that deploy facial recognition. You're almost guaranteeing that that facial recognition is going to make a mistake with a black individual, and you're reinforcing the sorts of existing issues that come into play when you talk about race and policing. And AI ethicists have to talk about these issues and try to change an industry that is making billions and billions of dollars. It is insanely profitable. You know, human personal data that is used to train these devices is called, tech gold. It's the new oil for Silicon Valley, and environmental activists will sympathize with this. But as soon as you try and change an industry that is making billions and billions of dollars, you're basically guaranteeing that you're going to go up against the most powerful and wealthy corporations in history. That's not a fight that's easy to win. So in my view, talking about quantum ethics now, and as you mentioned, quantum computing, throwing up that diagram again, ethics and rhetoric or hype and rhetoric is one of the core things that I personally talk a lot about in my own research. Oz and I are, working on a paper right now where we are basically saying this particular computing technology we're talking about is trash. It is no good. It is so far from any of the promises it is making. We should not take it seriously at all. That's an important part of our field. Another important part of our field is to recognize that if our discipline is 27, 28 years old, we have a unique opportunity to shape the values of that emerging community. To start this conversation now and to develop this conversation over the period of time it's going to take for quantum technology to arrive. And as you've mentioned, quantum sensing is closest of all of them to commercialization. It works. They need a couple orders of magnitude more precision before the oil companies are going to want it, and they need to get it ready to be deployable in the field. But quantum sensing has already delivered their proof of principle. Quantum computing has not. So we might see quantum sensing be marketable and profitable in the next 5 years. And then this conversation about the use case of quantum sensing in the environment is suddenly not going to seem like such a far cry from relevant. So it's my belief that starting this conversation now actually is the only thing we can do so that we can ensure when the technology gets here and is profitable, we already have guidelines in place. We already have a community of students who have been educated from undergraduate or graduate level or before about the importance of quantum ethics, that Oz is the one calling the shots. And her generation or newer students' generations are the ones who I would put my faith in to guide this technology in a positive direction. And so the only way to get that generation ready is to start now.
Amazing. Yeah, and I would add that we've seen so many times that every time there's a new technology coming to the general public's consciousness, we will have to have this conversation. So regardless if it's like quantum or any other, for example, like CRISPR, bioengineering things, they also have like this, they kind of have to have this like responsible research and innovation like things in place. And yeah, like Joan said, it's not, right now is the right time because we see that the policies especially do not catch up that well. So we saw this with AI or just an internet, like Facebook, hearings and stuff like that, or even again, like bioengineering stuff. So if we start talking now, we can get the policies to be in place sooner than later. So yeah.
So we did get one comment on there in the chat from Kristen that I think would be interesting. So we mentioned AI as kind of like a scenario where like, oh, that's, you know, one that we want to avoid. Are there success cases that we can point to? Are there places, other technologies that did get their responsible governance in time and were able to mitigate some of those potential disasters? It feels like it might be one of those things where it might be invisible work if it has worked in the past. But is there anything that, any examples that come to mind?
Yeah, so this is a question that I've talked with a couple of different people about. It's not a topic that I know that I would consider myself to be an expert in. But one example that I would point to is actually to Oz's point about the use of gene editing was the Asilomar conference. So this happened, gosh, I can't remember. It was some decades ago, maybe in the 1970s. But it was essentially a conference where the stated goal was to bring together everybody who was working in the field of gene science and to agree on a common set of ethical principles or values so that they could establish a foundation so that going forward, the community would be able to identify if someone was breaking those rules. And I'll actually give a shout out to a mentor of mine, Sam Weiss Evans, who I initially met when he was doing his work over at Harvard. He would probably be rolling his eyes right now if I'm talking about the Asilomar conference, because he's a bioethicist and he can point to the Swiss cheese of holes that are flaws that were in that conference. They did not bring in a lot of stakeholder engagement. They didn't really bring in the public. There were lots of problems with what they did. But when we're talking about technological fields and the ways that we create community values or external policies, Asilomar is kind of the example that I give to just say, you know, when my colleagues say, well, you know, what could we even really do about this? I'm just an algorithms guy. What can I really do? Well, I can say the community itself can do an Asilomar style convening where we agree on a set of core foundational principles. That's internal governance. But we also need external governance in the form of smart policy and regulation that says, hey, you know, maybe you shouldn't be able to use this technology to hurt people, and get specific about ways that the technology might do that. So I would say, and I should also point out that artificial intelligence researchers tried to do their own type of Asilomar conference and it didn't go anywhere. They weren't able to reach consensus. And there's a whole book length discussion about how that went wrong that I haven't read. So what I'll say in my answer, like my full answer to Kristen, is that regulating or creating guidelines or rules for emerging technological fields is a very new thing. And we are still trying to find the best ways to get it to work, because it's different for every technology in every era. And AI presents a lot of unique regulatory challenges. Oz and I, if you could put up the image of everybody from the summer school, Oz and I did co-organized a summer school that met over the course of 8 or 9 weeks. Where every week we had someone in to talk about a different issue. And one of those issues that we had someone come in to talk about was regulation of AI. And you can find that video on our YouTube channel. That's another image I shared with John. But the Quantum Ethics Project YouTube channel has videos that discuss ethical issues around poverty, environmentalism, race, regulation. We don't have all the answers. And this is why it's been so important for me to build out collaborations with policy experts, because those are the people that I would listen to when it comes to this question. So it's a weaselly answer, because I'm not really saying anything, Kristen. So apologies for that. But creating the spaces in which the conversations and collaborations and research around exactly your question can happen is why the Quantum Ethics Project exists in the first place.
Fantastic. So along those lines, so it is what you've built is something that has been, you know, really drawn in a lot of students like Oz from the region who are interested in pushing that forward. Oz, I was wondering, what advice would you have for people who might be trying to get a similar initiative up and running in their region, at their university, to other undergraduate and grad students who might be interested in developing something like that for their home?
Yes, so I would say for the Waterloo chapter, Joan really set the foundations for us really well. And one thing that I feel like I've learned from her is that you just need to network like crazy. And like, it was so cool to see how Joan was able to like get all these people from different backgrounds, like to come on this like quantum ethics conversation. And so I think you just need a little bit of creativity as well. Like, think of how other things can apply to your, like, whatever initiative that you're working at. And I guess kind of involve, like, if you're thinking of, like, campus-wide, I would even try to go out of the campus and look for other, like, for example, we are also affiliated with, like, not affiliated, but we also have, like, Perimeter Institute. And also just in like the larger region. So yeah, I don't know. Joan, do you have any, like, how did you set your foundations?
So is the question, how would people start a quantum ethics initiative or an initiative of other type?
Specifically focused on quantum ethics, let's say, or ethics in whatever technology they happen to be studying.
Then I would say reach out to Oz or myself and join our Discord server.
Yes.
It's got like 250 people in it. Many of them were from that 100 that I initially talked to, as well as others. And the whole point of building this community is so that it's easier for people than it was for me. And you don't have to get really lucky with a couple of early conversations and then network like crazy for a year and a half to even get somewhere. The Quantum Ethics Project Discord server community exists as a place where you can connect with other people who also care about the ethics of quantum. And you can connect with our reading resources. We have a whole reading list full of stuff that I've collected over the time I've been building the Quantum Ethics Project. And, you know, many of our core members are very active on that server. And, you know, we've had students get themselves research internships through the Discord server. We've had students find research collaborators through the Discord server. And again, the whole point is just, I've put together a community of some of the best experts in the world on this topic and put together a reading list of some of the best or most relevant resources on this topic. So whether you're interested in education or research or diversity or something else, I and the Quantum Ethics Project and Oz, with the Quantum Ethics Project chapter here in Canada, we are here to support you. So reach out.
Fantastic. On the other side of that coin, what can people in positions of power or responsibility do to help encourage these discussions, build ethics into the foundation of their group, their institute, their organization? What can people who do control some levers try to do?
Well, a big issue that I've seen come up when I talk to PhD students who are working on technical problems and they want to talk about ethics, I've had PhD students say they're worried that their advisor will reject the project, or that they'll, you know, it'll be seen as antithetical to their own work if they start trying to talk about the ethical concerns they have with their own research. So what I would say that what needs to happen from the leadership, there's this kind of a two-pronged approach. We're building the grassroots energy. Like, for example, let's use Waterloo as an example. Oz and the Waterloo chapter is building the grassroots energy that is required to show that there is interest in this field. What we need from the IQC, from the University of Waterloo, is to create spaces, initiatives to allocate funding for quantum ethics. Because this is a social problem now. This is just a problem of this field needs to be validated. And the only people that can give the signal that, yes, this field is important are the director of the IQC or the heads of their various departments within the university. Without the kind of program level acknowledgement of this field, it will continue to be a fringe topic. And just by a single person in a position of power saying, we're going to allocate little micro grants for students to work on projects like this, that instantly changes the conversation. Because now quantum ethics is a way for graduate students to get funding and publications. And it's a fruitful area of research. And in my own experience as a technical researcher, exploring ethical topics made the questions I was asking in my technical work better. It makes everything better. And we have the interest at the grassroots level. So this question is particularly important, John, because, and I'll actually make it personal. Something you could do is to create an ethics component of your use QIP, to create an ethics lab day or a component for the lab days for high school students, to create an ethics portion of the QSIS summer school program, so that at every single place where students interact with the IQC, they're seeing ethics. And we need to do this for the graduate student seminar within the IQC. We need a recurring lecture topic on the subject. We need students at the graduate level and undergraduate level to see that people from the top down care. And if the students pursue these topics, that they will be supported. And then you'll see that it'll break wide open and you'll get a lot of impressive work done. And I've said this a couple different times, but this is how Canada remains relevant in the global quantum stage. Canada has always been an early mover on quantum, and that's why the IQC has had its historic position within the quantum space. And now Canada, when I say Canada, I'm talking about the IQC, needs to be an early mover on this issue too. So that again, the dollars that the Canadian government is investing in quantum are helpful. The new National Quantum Strategy put in $360 million, which is no small feat. But compare that to the US, Europe, or China, it's a drop in the bucket. So in order to remain globally relevant, Canada can and should take on the mantle of ethical leader, because that's what it's done historically. And the quantum should be no different.
Good call to action. All right. So I thank you both so much for joining today. It's been a wonderful conversation. I do want to make sure there is a little bit of time at the end just to acknowledge the fact that when bringing something like this together, it really is a team effort. What you mentioned earlier, the summer school, for example, what mix of expertise is needed to make a project like this a success?
Oz, you want to?
I would say, so in our chapter, we have people from the Critical Media Lab, and we have people from University of Guelph, and we have people from Perimeter. So I think having people from different institutions was really crucial. And in terms of expertise, I would say the conversations that I saw and had on the Discord channel, for example, some people are from the backgrounds of science and technology studies.
Science and technology and society studies.
Yes, STS. I always say STS. So I'm like, oh, I forgot.
I get the acronym.
But yeah, I would say the just like how we talked on interdisciplinary previously, it's
And to jump into, I would say, and this is kind of my biggest call to action for the Quantum Ethics Project as an organization, which is if an institute is doing research on quantum and they need help getting the expertise on ethics, that's what we're here to do. And so my collaborator, Rodrigo, and I are going to be at the Quantum for Business Conference in Silicon Valley in December, where we are going to be pitching our organization as a consulting firm that is here to ensure that an organization doesn't have to put the interdisciplinary expertise together on their own, that we've already thought through that. We already have that community. We already have that expertise. Oz is absolutely right. We need people with the technical background. We also need people. The Critical Media Lab is based out of the English department. Whether you're talking about philosophy people like Dr. Dorian Frazier that Oz mentioned previously, or English people, or basically anybody who works in policy, these are critical pieces of the pie.
All right. So if people do want to learn more, they can visit quantumethicsproject.org. They can reach out to you and Oz to join the Discord. Are there any other resources that you would point them towards?
I guess we have our Instagram, and I mean, if you go to the Quantum Ethics Project website, you can see all the links. And for the Waterloo people, just look out for any posters. We do a lot of postering when we have events, and you can reach out to FemFiz, and that's where we have our quantum ethics discussions. So if you search up FemFiz, you can find our information.
I would say follow us on Instagram at @quantum_ethics. Go to our website. The website has a community blog where we have some of the conversations that take place in the Discord server percolate up and turn into a blog post. If folks are interested in contributing to that blog, again, they can reach out to Oz or myself. And then I think if people are interested in the reading list, we have a Zotero. So people who may not be familiar with Zotero, it's a publication management system, but it's basically where all of our readings and resources are, various papers and things. It's certainly not comprehensive, but it's a good starting point for people to start seeing what are these papers referencing, and then you can kind of get a sense of what the scholarly work in the field is up to this point.
Fantastic. Joan and Oz, thank you so much again for joining us. Thank you to everyone who tuned in. Thank you for the fantastic questions. We'll be announcing more Quantum Todays, likely starting up again in January. And until then, note that once again, a reminder that the applications for Use QIP, if you're an undergraduate student interested in getting some experience, they're open until January 2nd. Thank you again for joining us, and have a wonderful week, everyone.
Thank you, John. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you.
Pleasure is all ours.
Thank you.